In the last class, we were talking about Kirchhoff's law. And Kirchhoff's law relates the ability of a surface to absorb radiation with its ability to emit radiation. The most fundamental statement of Kirchhoff's law is that the directional spectral absorptivity is equal to the directional spectral emissivity. And the only condition for this is that there has to be local thermodynamic equilibrium. Now, we like to know when we can say the hemispherical spectral emissivity is equal to hemispherical spectral absorptivity. Now, this is not always true. It is true, we saw in the last class, if surface is a diffuse isotropic emitter, by which we mean that the directional spectral emissivity is not a function of theta and phi. So, such a surface we will call it as a DI surface, diffuse isotropic. Here, diffuse is a word used to indicate that this is not a function of theta, and phi is used to indicate that emissivity is not a function of azimuth angle phi. So, this is one requirement. Or the second requirement that can be imposed is that the radiation that is incident on the object is not a function of theta or phi. So, what you saw that in order to make sure that the hemispherical spectral absorptivity is equal to hemispherical spectral emissivity, we have to put a condition either on the surface or on the incoming radiation. Either the surface has to have a property which is independent of angle, or the incoming radiation has to be independent of angle. And as you can imagine, in real world situation that we face, the chances that the incoming radiation is independent of angle theta and phi is very rare. It can occur in a condition outside the laboratory under cloudy conditions. The radiation from the sun may be roughly equal in all direction, but in most other situations that you encounter, incoming radiation will be a function of theta and phi. So, this is not something we can use, but this condition, the surface being diffuse isotropic, although not that common, can be a good approximation. We will see later when we look at actual properties of surfaces that the assumption that a real surface which is really not diffuse isotropic, if you assume it diffuse isotropic, you may make an error in the estimate of the hemispherical value, and that error can be of the order of 10%. Now, this kind of error is usually accepted in this subject, because data on radiative property surfaces is not easily available. They are not tabulated extensively, as is the case with thermal conductivity or other properties of surfaces. So, and the accuracy of these tabulations is also not that reliable. And therefore, as an engineer, one may be willing to make an approximation which causes an error which is less than the error in the input data. So, in any real life problem, we have to have data from some source, and if you believe that that data can cause an error of the order of 10%, then one should not be unhappy about making an approximation which is of the order of 10%. So, what I would say is that in many engineering problems, one would not make a large error if one were to assume the surface is a diffuse isotropic emitter. And hence, Kirchhoff's law in this form is useful in many real life situations. Now, let us go to the other approximations which we applied Kirchhoff's law. Can we apply Kirchhoff's law of the form directional total emissivity is equal to directional total absorptivity? Now, we saw in the last class that this can be assumed if the directional spectral emissivity of the surface was not a function of lambda. This is called a gray surface. Gray surface is one whose radiative properties is independent of wavelength. Now, this is not very common because most surfaces, as we will see later, show strong variation of emissivity with wavelength. So, this approximation can be done in a few cases, but may not be a good approximation. Now, in case you cannot assume the surface to be gray, then the only choice you have is to assume that the incoming radiation is proportional to radiation from a black body at the temperature of the surface. Now, this is useful because if you recall in the last lecture, the expression for emissivity was directional spectral emissivity weighted by the black body emissivity at and divided by sigma T s to the power of 4 by pi. Now, this was a value that we obtained. The other way to do it, let me tightly change this for so that it compares with the what we will now do for absorptivity. So, let me write this as 0 infinity I prime lambda b of T s d lambda. Now, let us compare that with absorptivity, which was so the primary difference between absorptivity and emissivity calculation while integrating over wavelength is in the case of emissivity, we are using the intensity spectral variation of black body intensity at the surface temperature as a weighting factor, while in the case of absorptivity is the spectral variation of the incoming radiation. Now, these two can be equal only if either the emissivity is independent of wavelength and comes out of the integral, in which case these things cancel out and you get the first condition, or if by chance the intensity of the incoming radiation happens to be proportional to the black body intensity at the temperature surface. Now, that is going to be very rare. It is a rare occasion in a real world where the radiation impinging on an object happens to be similar to a black body intensity at the surface temperature of the object. In a laboratory, you may arrange it. For example, if you are doing an experiment, you might be able to arrange a source which is proportional to the intensity of the black body radiation at the surface temperature. But in all other real life situation outside the laboratory, this condition can never be met. Therefore, what I want to highlight is the chances that you will be able to assume that the directional total emissivity is equal to directional total absorptivity will be very rare, because there are very few surfaces in the real world which are gray, that is properties are independent wavelength, and there are very few situations in the real world where the radiation impinging on object happens to be proportional to the black body intensity at the surface temperature. So, this is an approximation one has to make with great care, but you will see many textbooks where they will state this condition as the Kirchhoff's law. So, I want to emphasize the fact that Kirchhoff's law is only states that directional spectral emissivity equals directional spectral absorptivity. Kirchhoff's law does not say directional total emissivity equal directional total absorptivity. These two can be equal only if one of these two conditions satisfied, and as you saw just now, there are not too many occasions that you will get to be able to make this kind of assumption. So, one has to use this kind of approximation with great care. Sometimes in real life engineering problems, you are forced to make certain approximations, but one should do so knowing full well the consequences and the error that may be introduced by these approximations. Now, let us go to the most general this one. One would like to assume that the hemispherical total emissivity equals hemispherical total absorptivity. There are books which state this is Kirchhoff's law. This is not Kirchhoff's law. This is a condition where we have started on Kirchhoff's law, and you have to do two integrations, one over wavelength and the other over angle, to get at this point. And in order to for these two to be equal, you have to impose conditions on the directional property of the surface or the incoming radiation, and the spectral properties of the surface or the incoming radiation. So, let us, based on what we have done so far, let us stipulate what are the conditions. What are conditions can we need to satisfy? Now, this follows directly from what we already done through wavelength or angle integration. And when these two done, these things are done together, then you need to pose two conditions in each case. For example, you can say that the surface is gray and diffuse isotropic emitter. So, you are imposing your condition only on the surface. You claim the surface is gray and it is diffuse isotropic. This is very, very rare. There are not too many real life situations where you will find surface is both gray and emits in a diffuse isotropic fashion. So, this is a very rare situation, but if that happens, then you are lucky, then these two are equal. Or the second possibility is you keep the surface as gray and it so happens that the incoming radiation is not depending on angle. So, incoming radiation is coming equally in all directions and the surface is gray. That is one more way to get this to be equal. This also is of course very rare. Or the third is that the incoming radiation is proportional to the black body intensity at the surface temperature, and the surface is diffuse isotropic. So, you have assumed surface has no angular dependence of emissivity, and you are hoping that the incoming radiation happens to be that from a black body at the surface temperature. Again, these two are very rare conditions to be met in real world. Or finally, you can assume that the incoming radiation is again proportional to black body intensity at the temperature, and also this radiation is not a function of angle, it is incident uniformly onto your surface. So, you can see there are four conditions under which you can have hemispherical spectral emissivity equal to hemispherical spectral absorptivity. Hemispherical total emissivity is equal to hemispherical total absorptivity, but all these four conditions are rarely satisfied. So, in general, it is important to recognize that this is can rarely be used. This assumption that hemispherical total emissivity equals hemispherical total absorptivity can rarely be used, and this has to be kept in mind in real world situations. There are occasions where one may be forced to make such an approximation, but if you do so, you must carefully examine the results you get by making such an approximation, because it may lead to serious errors in your estimate of radiative fluxes or some other property. And if the errors are large, then you have to go back and question whether this assumption is valid or not. I want to repeat once more that there are books which state the above equation as the Kirchhoff's law. Above equation is not the Kirchhoff's law. Kirchhoff's law says directional spectral emissivity is equal to directional spectral absorptivity. That's always valid in engineering situation. But if you want to make assumption that the hemispherical spectral emissivity, hemispherical total emissivity is equal to hemispherical total absorptivity, then you have to make one of these four assumptions, which are not usually true in real world situations. But if you are lucky and such a thing does occur, then you can make this approximation. Now, later in this course, we will do problems in which we may make such assumption, knowing full well that it is not a good approximation, but it is done in the classroom in a way to solve some simple problems to illustrate some feature of radiative transfer, knowing full well that in the real world this may not be valid. It is more a teaching tool rather than solving a real problem. So, that we will do, and that must be kept in mind, and that should not be confused with the applicability of this assumption in the real world. Okay. So, we have spent a lot of time discussing Kirchhoff's law, because in many textbooks in heat transfer, Kirchhoff's law is treated rather casually in a rather cavalier fashion, and there are books which state that alpha equals epsilon is Kirchhoff's law. There are books which state alpha lambda equals epsilon lambda is Kirchhoff's law, and there are other books which state alpha prime equals epsilon from Kirchhoff's law. All these are not true. The only true statement is alpha prime lambda equals epsilon prime lambda, which is the basic statement of Kirchhoff's law. The other assumptions, other equalities that people use are valid under certain stringent assumptions, and it is important to ask yourself whether those assumptions are really valid. As I pointed out, there are real world situations where you will be forced to make some assumption, but we must do that consciously and be ready to examine the consequence of making such an assumption on our estimate of either radiative fluxes or temperature, and be ready to evaluate the impact of an assumption on the error in the estimates of some values. So, as long as you are fully aware of the assumption that you have made and its consequences, you can make some assumption and see what happens. So, this we will also examine frequently, because in this course we will make some of these assumptions, because that simplifies the problem substantially. But when ultimately we compare the results we obtain with the real world and we find there are large differences, we must be willing to go back and question some of the assumptions we have made. Now, that completes the discussion on Kirchhoff's law, which is a very important law in radiation heat transfer and a law which has been misquoted and misused in many situations. Now, so far we looked at absorptivity and emissivity, two important properties of a surface, but these properties are not directly measured. For example, if you want to measure emissivity of a surface, you should compare the emission of that surface with that of a black body at the same temperature. Now, that is not easy to perform in the laboratory, taking a ratio of the real emission to that of a black body same temperature. Similarly, in order to measure absorptivity of a surface, you must measure the amount of radiation absorbed and divide it by the radiation incident. Even this is not easy to do. It is done in certain special laboratories. So, these are quantities which are not easy to measure directly. So, the traditional method of estimating emissivity and absorptivity is not through direct measurement of these quantities, but by indirect inference, by measuring reflectivity. Reflectivity is a property which is somewhat easier to measure. You send a ray, a radiation impinging on object, measure how much is reflected, and we will see immediately that once you have measured the reflectivity of an object, you can infer from there what is the absorptivity by applying the first law of thermodynamics. Now, reflectivity is a quantity which is somewhat complicated. Now, why is this complicated? It is because reflectivity depends on two angles. Suppose this is a surface with a certain normal and radiation is coming in at a certain angle theta, incident angle theta I, and with respect to some reference it has azimuth angle phi I, and radiation is reflected in some other angle. This is incoming, this is outgoing. So, that angle is theta r and the azimuth angle is, let us say, phi r. So, straight away you see that problem is more complicated, because the reflectivity rho depends on, of course, wavelength, depends on two angles. So, I put two primes here to remind you two angles. The angles are a function of theta I phi I theta r phi r and of course wavelength. So, there are two angles involved, the incident angle and the outgoing angle. So, the basic quantity in reflectivity is called the bidirectional spectrum. So, this is a bidirectional spectral reflectivity. So, let us see what the definition is. Definition is somewhat different from what we have used earlier. It is the intensity of the reflected radiation at angle theta r and phi r divided by the radiation incident at a given angle theta I phi I times the incident angle cos theta I and the incident solid angle. So, this definition you can see somewhat more complicated than that for emissivity and absorptivity. So, we are comparing the intensity of the reflected radiation to the total intensity of the incoming radiation. Although this is the basic quantity of interest to us, the quantity which is very relevant to us is not this one. We want to know all the energy incident in this surface at angle theta I phi a, how much is reflected in all directions, because this is only talking about reflection in one direction. And from the perspective of first law of thermodynamics, all you want to know is of the total radiation that is impinging on object, how much is absorbed and how much is reflected. We do not really care in what direction is reflected. So, we would like to integrate over all outgoing angles. So, we will define now the a quantity called directional hemispherical reflectivity. So, the unit of the symbols for this is rho prime lambda. It will be a function only of incoming radiation, because we are integrating over all outgoing angles. So, we are not concerned about where the radiation reflected. We want to know what is the total radiation reflected over all angles, or an entire hemisphere above the surface. The reason why this quantity is very important is that this follows from first law. Suppose you have a direct spectral absorptivity for radiation coming in at angle theta I phi I. This plus energy reflected in all directions is equal to 1. So, this follows from the first law of thermodynamics. Of the total radiation that is impinging on an object, let us call that as dq prime lambda I. Certain radiation is absorbed and certain radiation is reflected in all directions. So, if you divide by this now, you will get the above thing which you wrote by inspection. So, we divide by this, sorry. So, you can see that this quantity alpha prime lambda is nothing but ratio of the energy absorbed, energy incident, and the directional spectral reflectivity, directional hemispheric reflectivity is nothing but ratio of energy reflected in all direction to that incident. So, this follows from the first law of thermodynamics for an opaque surface. The surface is not opaque, then we will have to extend this. I will show that in the next next. Now, suppose the surface is not opaque. Let us imagine you have a glass. A glass can absorb radiation, it can reflect radiation, it can transmit radiation. So, in such a case, we must extend this to a the total radiation incident can either be absorbed or reflected or transmitted. Okay, now we divide by this quantity everywhere, we get 1 here. So, this 1 will be equal to, this is by definition alpha prime lambda, this by definition is rho prime lambda, this by definition is tau prime lambda. So, all we are saying is the fraction of radiation absorbed, the fraction of radiation reflected in all direction, fraction of radiation transmitted has to be equal to 1. For an opaque surface, we have tau prime lambda is 0. Therefore, alpha prime lambda plus rho prime lambda equals 1. So, this is a very useful equation because it is difficult to measure absorptivity directly by measuring these two quantities. It is easier to measure reflectivity. So, by measuring reflectivity, you can infer what is the absorptivity from this equation. Now, we apply Kirchhoff's law. So, this equation is what we had for opaque surface. We apply Kirchhoff's law, we get epsilon prime lambda equal alpha prime lambda. So, you get another equation now. So, you can see that we can infer the emissivity of a surface, the directional spectral emissivity, by measuring the directional hemispherical reflectivity. So, this equation is used frequently to infer the absorptivity and emissivity of surfaces without directly measuring them, but by indirectly inferring them by measuring reflectivity. So, this is quite common because instruments for measuring reflectivity are available and you measure those values and from there you infer the emissivity and absorptivity of these surfaces. But as you recall, reflectivity is a somewhat a complex quantity. But here we are dealing only with hemispherical, directional hemispherical quantity, which is similar to absorptivity and emissivity. But real surfaces, for example, can be very easy. They can reflect like a mirror. These are called specular surfaces. So, they reflect like a mirror and they follow the Snell's law, which you have learnt in your schools. Or there are surfaces which reflect equally in all directions. So, this is a diffuse reflector. But all real surfaces are in between, they are neither purely specular nor real purely diffuse. In a real surface, part of the reflection will be similar to a mirror, the remaining part will be varying with direction. So, the real challenge is to characterize such a surface, but if you average over all outgoing angles, and get the directional hemispherical value, then you really don't worry about the nature of the reflected radiation. Later in this course, you will see that there are some situations wherein it becomes important to know the direction in which radiation is reflected. For example, suppose you have a wall, okay, two walls here adjacent to each other, and radiation is coming from sun, and impinges on this wall. And you want to know how much radiation hits this wall. So, this is wall 1, this is wall 2. Radiation comes from the sun, hits wall 1, and on reflection hits wall 2. This could be a house, for example. So, what you want to know from the pavement in front of the house, how much radiation reflected and enters your house. If you want to know that, you must have a detailed account of how the energy is reflected by this pavement. So, depending on the directional variation of reflectivity, you can estimate how much of the reflected radiation enters your house. So, for such situation, you need a detailed account of how much energy is reflected in one direction by such a surface. On the other hand, if you are only interested in understanding the temperature of wall 1, the temperature of wall 1 does not depend on how much energy is reflected in which direction. It mainly depends on how much radiation is absorbed from the sun. So, this quantity, and you only want an estimate of how much radiation is reflected in all directions by the surface. So the same problem for estimating the temperature of wall 1, you do not need detailed information about in which direction the radiation is reflected. But to estimate the temperature of wall 2, you need to know what fraction of the radiation from the sun is reflected into this direction. So, you can see clearly that depending on the problem and the situation, certain information is very necessary, or in some other situation it may be not necessary. So, that is the difficulty with the property reflectivity. In certain situation, you do not need details about where radiation reflected, but in certain other situations, you have to worry about where the radiation is reflected. Now, before we get into these applications, we need to now have an understanding about, more understanding about emissivity and absorptivity. For that, I want to take an example which illustrates the difference between absorbed and emissivity. I take example of metals. Metals which are pure and smooth. That is, they are not rough, they are finished very smoothly. Now, such metals which are prepared with a very smooth finish and they are absolutely pure, one can show that for such metals, the directional spectral emissivity can be written as some constant, which is a property of the metal, times the square root of temperature of the surface and inverse proportional to the square root of the wavelength. This is an approximation, this is not always valid. Let us assume that this is valid for a surface. So, one wants to know, if this is given, what is the value of the directional total emissivity and what is the value of directional total absorptivity. So, that is what we want to calculate. If you recall, the directional total emissivity can be written as 0 to infinity epsilon prime lambda E lambda b d lambda by sigma th to the power of 4. This is the basic definition of directional total emissivity, and you have been given this information about emissivity here. So, we can take the b out, b is a constant. So, we can write this as Ts is not a function of wavelength. So, we have 1 over root lambda E lambda b d lambda, sigma can come out. Here you have Ts to the power of 4. Now, if you recall from the previous lectures, one of the interesting properties of E lambda b by Ts to the power of 5 was that is function only of lambda t. This was a useful result you can infer from the basic Planck's black body formula. Now, we are going to exploit that here for to our advantage. We will use that and then we will write down epsilon prime as b root Ts by sigma. Now, we want this to be a function of lambda t only. So, multiply up and down by root Ts. So, one more root Ts comes in here, and here you also multiply up and down by Ts. So, you get 0 to infinity 1 by root lambda Ts E lambda b by Ts to the power of 5 and d lambda t. Okay. Now, we notice that this thing which is circled here is a function only of lambda t. Okay. So, the entire lambda Ts. So, the entire integral here contains only lambda Ts. So, this quantity will be some number. So, let us now write that down in the next page. So, epsilon prime is coming out in this case to be b Ts by sigma 0 to infinity 1 over root lambda Ts function of lambda Ts d lambda Ts. This and the limits are 0 to infinity. So, this quantity is some number. As far as we are concerned right now, we do not worry about what the number is. Let us say this number is a constant C, let us say equal to C, some number, and this can be evaluated. It is not difficult today with so many standard packages like MATLAB available. You can integrate this function. You know this function, this is a black body function. You can get this number. It is a numerical value. And so, let us assume that this C into B is some B tilde. So, we define B tilde as B into C for convenience. So, this quantity becomes B tilde into Ts. I also put sigma in this, so that is very easy. Sigma also included in this definition. Bc by sigma is B tilde. So, finally, we get a simple result that for metals under certain approximation, the directional total emissivity is linearly proportional to the surface temperature. We will see later that this is shown to be reasonably accurate based on experimental observations. When you plot the directional total emissivity of a metal with temperature, in many cases, not all, it falls in a linear assumption is quite valid. Now, the next question we want to pose is, what is the value of alpha prime? Now, this is a little more complicated than epsilon prime, because as you recall, the definition of alpha prime is 0 to infinity alpha prime lambda I prime lambda I d lambda divided by over the entire total radiation coming over the entire wavelength. And on applying Kirchhoff's law, you can write this as now our problem is that we cannot perform this integration unless someone gives us the spectral variation of the incoming radiation. Now, in real life, this can be quite complicated depending upon the environment which the surface is there. The incoming radiation can vary with wavelength in a variety of ways. Now, if that is given to us, of course, we can calculate this. But let us take a simple case where the incoming radiation happens to be, let us say, some constant A times a black body radiation intensity at some temperature T I. In general, T I is not equal to surface temperature. So, if that is the case, that equation now becomes alpha prime is equal to, for the metals we are considering, you can write B root T s by lambda I prime lambda B of T I d lambda divided by 0 to infinity I prime lambda B of T I into d lambda. Okay. So, what we have here now is an expression which straight away tells you the complexity that we are encountering, which is that the directional spectral, directional total absorptivity is a function of both surface temperature and the temperature of the incoming radiation, if it is a black body radiation. Okay. This is different from directional total emissivity, which is only a function of surface temperature. So, the reason why I took the example is for you to clearly appreciate the fundamental difference between emissivity and absorptivity. Emissivity is a property of a surface. Once we know the type of surface, that is metal, non-metal or something else, and then the nature of surface, smooth, rough or other information, and its temperature, we can estimate the emissivity irrespective of what radiation is impinging on it. For example, I can have a surface at a temperature of, let us say, 100 degrees centigrade inside the room, subjected to radiation from the lamps. The emissivity of that surface will be same when I take it out and put on sunlight, but keep the surface temperature same, the emissivity will be same whether you are inside the room or outside. On the other hand, the same surface, the absorptivity of the surface will be different inside the room and outside. Inside the room, the absorptivity will depend on the nature of the incoming radiation, the radiation from the lamp or from the wall. Well, outside, that surface is subjected to solar radiation and hence is absorptively different. So, absorptivity is very much dependent upon the environment in which that surface is placed. Well, emissivity depends only on the surface temperature, the nature of the surface, metal or non-metal, and the surface finish. So, this is a point I want you to remember, and to make this very clear, I have taken this example. But some of you may wonder, if absorptivity and emissivity are so fundamentally different, while one depends only on the surface condition and temperature, while the other depends on incoming radiation, how come the Kirchhoff's law is valid? The Kirchhoff's law says that directional spectral absorptivity equals directional spectral emissivity. Now, you must remember, Kirchhoff's law is applicable at the most basic level, that is the directional spectral level, and it is postulated by Kirchhoff that the two are equal at that level, because at the microscopic level, absorption and emission are equally probable events. If there is a surface which has a high absorptivity in a given direction, given wavelength, that surface should also have a high emissivity in the same direction, same wavelength. But when you ask questions related to hemispherical quantity or quantity average over all wavelength, that is the total quantity, then that quantity will depend upon the nature of the incoming radiation. So, you must recognize that the directional spectral quantity is connected directly to the microscopic processes that operate in any surface, while the hemispherical and total quantities are dependent upon the environment in which that surface is placed. So, Kirchhoff's law is rigorously valid only for directional spectral quantity, is not applicable without approximations to hemispherical quantities or spectrally average quantities. Now, let us proceed further on this derivation. So, we will find that alpha prime, which is now function of Ts and Ti, is equal to, of course, B. You can bring root Ts out, can bring the sigma out. Now, we will have to multiply by root Ti. That is necessary because the black body function is a function of Ti here. So, then you have 0 to infinity 1 over root lambda Ti E lambda B of Ti by Ti to the power of 5 D lambda Ti. I want you to compare this particular expression with what we use for emissivity. In emissivity, what we had was Ts and Ts and Ts here. But now, we have brought in Ti, because that is the incoming radiation temperature. And once more, I want to remind you that this is a function only of lambda Ti. So, the entire quantity is a number. That number is same as the number we obtained earlier, that is equal to a C, the entire thing. Because this integral does not depend on whether you write Ti or Ts here, because going from 0 to infinity, that quantity, if you evaluate numerically, you will get a constant C same as before. So, this can be written as P C by sigma as before into root Ts Ti. Okay. So, this we have already defined as B tilde. So, we have shown now that alpha prime is B tilde root Ts Ti. Well, earlier we showed epsilon prime is B tilde into Ts. So, this is a fundamental difference between directional total emissivity and direct total absorptivity. Emissivity is linearly proportional to the surface temperature. The directional total absorptivity in this case is proportional to square root of surface temperature and the temperature of the incoming radiation, if it is a black body. This is a very important result. You can see that the ratio of absorptivity to emissivity of this surface is equal to root of Ti by Ts. So, this is a very important distinction we must root Ts by root Ti, I am sorry, it is root Ti by Ts. So, this is a very important result because it is showing that directional total absorptivity is not equal to total emissivity, and the ratio depends upon the surface temperature and the term incoming radiation. And also you can see that if Ti equals Ts, then of course, epsilon prime equals alpha prime. That is a special case, but in general they are not equal. And so, this is the reason why the derivation was done to illustrate and to convince you that in general, the total absorptivity of a surface is not equal to total emissivity. It only occurs in rare situation like a gray surface, that is surface whose radiative properties are independent of wavelength, or an unusual situation like this where the radiation is coming in is such that it is similar to that of a black body at the surface temperature, that is Ti equals Ts. In such a case, these two are equal, but in general they are not equal, and I will reinforce this again in the next lecture. So, in this lecture we discuss in detail the Kirchhoff's law, and we showed clearly that the equality of absorptivity emissivity in general can only be obtained under very special conditions, and we set out those conditions clearly. And in the next class, we will illustrate the importance of Kirchhoff's law in practical applications like solar collectors. Thank you.